Hello, everyone, and welcome to another great episode of the Jason Howell Company Speaker Series Zoominars. As always, I'm happy to bring a wealth of information and content and really just expertise from the people that are in my network that I'm now going to be sharing with you and your network, just some fascinating people. Today is no exception. We have Paty Funegra out of Arlington from Global Advisors. She's going to share a little bit of some of the work that she's been doing, obviously, in and with Central America and the economic development opportunities that are available there as well. Paty, how are you? How are you doing? Which is what you normally say, but I happen to know, and I think most of us who registered for this event happen to know, that you fell ill last week. So Paty, tell us a little bit about your experience over the past week.
Thank you, Jason, and welcome everybody behind the scenes. We never know here on Zoom who is joining us. Yes, unfortunately, I thought that I was safe because I received the vaccine, the two doses of the vaccine in April. So I didn't wear mask anymore. I lived my life like everything was back to normal. And 10 days ago, exactly, I got infected with the virus, and so has my entire household. So it is, as I said to you, Jason, before, this is not a joke. This is a serious business, and we should take it as is and take care of ourselves and take care of our community, wearing masks and vaccinating for the ones that haven't done yet. But now I'm back. I don't have a sense of smell or taste yet, but I'm back and ready to rock it.
Well, we are so happy to have you, Paty. This was an event that I know a number of people were excited to join live last week, and we had to reschedule. The good news is, for anyone that isn't with us live today and can't ask their questions today, we are recording this presentation. We will send it out to all registrants. And of course, we are live right now on Facebook. So if you're on Facebook and you want to say hello, please go right ahead and do so. Okay, for now, I'm going to go ahead and share my screen and we can start with our event here. Okay. If you came to Central America Entrepreneurship versus Charity, you came to the right event. We are so happy to have Patricia Funegra here to share with us a little bit of her insights from her history, from her experience, and what she's doing with a brand new company to start doing some economic development within Central America. But before we get to that, let's just have a word from our sponsor. And of course, our sponsor is Jason Howell Company. Our company is a family wealth management firm. Our goal is to ensure that your family and your values are reflected in how you want to manage your money. We do this through a unique family governance process that delivers not just a financial plan, but also a family constitution. We also help clients with stock options invest sustainably and become proactive philanthropically, if that's your bent. So it's about your family, it's about your values, it's about your money. Jason Howell Company. Okay, for more information, just go to jasonhowell.com. And with that, we'll go to our star of the day from her brand new firm, Global Development Advisors, Ms. Paty Funegra, who's well known in Arlington, Virginia, certainly. Paty, before we got into the Q&A, I just wanted to take a couple of minutes and walk through pieces of this background. And there are very few people in the world who have actually done a TEDx presentation. You are one of those few people. Tell us about Food, the Catalyst for Greatness, because I think it connects to your first firm, La Cocina Virginia. So please tell us about that presentation you gave way back when.
Thank you, Jason. Yes, I'm a former executive from the Inter-American Development Bank, which is an institution that serves the Latin America, Central America, and the Caribbean region with economic support to improve education, health, democracy, and all the different aspects that countries in those places of the world suffer from. But I quit my job and in 2014 started La Cocina VA with the goal to support immigrants, Latino immigrants, that in this region of the country come mostly from Central America, from El Salvador, from Honduras, and from Guatemala. The La Cocina VA has been offering for 7 years workforce and entrepreneurship development programs that provide these individuals with capacity building training, industry credentials, and with jobs, and also training and access to infrastructure to develop small businesses. But Jason, my vision was always helping more, tackling the causes that make these families and these individuals flee their countries in the first place. So that's why and how I am transitioning from La Cocina VA, which serves locally immigrants, to a global approach that will tackle and work hard to mitigate or eliminate the reasons why our immigrant friends come from the Central America region.
Such important work. And we are going to get into some of that with the handful of questions that we have. As a note, if any of you have questions, go right ahead and put them in the chat. I will read them aloud so Paty can speak to them. But before we do that, Paty, I wanted to talk just a little bit about being a speaker at the U.S. Department of State's Bureau of International Information Program in 2018. I don't think this program is still available or is happening now, but share just a minute about your experience doing that.
Yes, the Department of State promote economic development, workforce development, and entrepreneurship development through this particular program, bringing experts from the United States on different fields to share with developing countries, with local representatives, with universities, with grassroots organizations in these countries, the expertise, best practices and programming that U.S. institutions are implementing to promote economic development. So I was invited by the Department of State in 2018 to travel some of the developing world. Central America was the focus. I was in Africa and also working in Iraq with social entrepreneurs. And that is when, Jason, I was able to see firsthand the talent, the passion, the drive that entrepreneurs in these countries, and particularly for this conversation in Central America, all that exists there. At the same time, I was able to experience the barriers and challenges that they face to succeed in these endeavors and these enterprises. So that was a very rich experience that just sparked and triggered this the creation of Global Development Advisors at this point.
It's amazing once you get out of our bubble here in the United States and really start seeing parts of the world, how much inspiration can come from that. And it helps when it's someone like you who's really taken the time to execute and say, what can I do? Well, her bio is here. Check out this TEDx talk. It's called Food, the Catalyst for Greatness. Of course, she's got a great education behind her as well. Paty does Harvard, Georgetown, even Universidad
Peruana de Ciencias Aplicadas.
Yeah, how was that school? Tell us a little bit about it. Most of us don't know.
So that was in my previous life, yes. when I lived in Peru, which is the country I was born at. So it's a business administration. I did a business administration career there, work in different industries.
Was it a big school, this school?
It's a business school, yeah.
Was it big though, or was it smaller?
Oh, no, it's a large business school. A university that has a business school, okay. In Lima. Mostly based headquartered in Lima, Peru.
Wonderful. Well, thanks. Like I said, I think we knew a couple of the names, but not that one. And I'm happy to have you share it with everyone. Okay, well, let's get to our Q&A. We have a handful of questions here, and I know that there will be opportunities to add color to them. So we'll just kind of go through them. But let's start where some of the beginning began, with La Cocina, Virginia. How did your work at La Cocina, Virginia inspire you to build Global Impact Advisors?
Yes, as I mentioned before, working with Latin American and basically the group of Central American clients that La Cocina VA serves inspired me to go farther. You know, the recent survey done by Catholic Relief Services shows that 75% of individuals in Guatemala never want to leave their countries, that 95% of them are very much attached to their communities. They don't want to leave, but they have to because of the lack of opportunities that exist. So we at La Cocina work with them, serve them, helping improve their opportunities. But I think the biggest problem is preventing them from having to flee their countries, helping them to create those wealth, create wealth and prosperity and better futures in their countries. So that's when Global Development Advisors is born, to provide those three countries with an intervention, a project that has three different phases with long-term, mid and long-term impact projected. But I guess, Jason, we will go a little bit in more detail to discuss that part. I think I see you have very interesting questions coming
yes.
up.
Yes, we try to be interesting. And so if I understand you correctly, you mentioned this a little bit before, La Cocina Virginia, when you founded that organization, and it's still going strong, that as you learned, as you worked through it, you realized it was really hitting the symptoms of an issue that you cared about. You were taking care of people once they were here, giving them an opportunity to work, to learn a craft. But as you worked through it, you wanted to go after some of the root causes of those symptoms. And so that follow-up question connects here. How would you describe the root causes that we see on the US border, on the news? How does that all connect?
Yes, unfortunately, there is a need for very fundamental reform in these countries to reduce violence, to reduce guns activities, to mitigate and hopefully at some point eliminate this transnational criminal organization that exists, that endemic corruption that doesn't let these countries thrive. As we probably have heard, I don't know who the audience today is, but the Biden administration is proposing a strategy, a four-year, $4 billion strategy that looks and proposes to address these very issues. And what they are proposing makes sense at the macro level, which is improving the rule of law, improving security for its citizens, combating this endemic corruption, mobilizing private capital to be invested in these countries, prioritize poverty alleviation and economic development at all the levels of the system. However, though, we know at the same time that these efforts alone are not enough to create the real transformation and the economic development that is needed. Unfortunately, our government tends to pay attention to the most urgent matters, in this case, the massive migration, and then look somewhere else. At this point, we have to do things differently. Massive migration is not a short-term problem that could be solved with short-term solutions. That is why part of what we are proposing is, as a concept, as a philosophy, is to approach this issue in a more cross-sector collective impact approach, where we all share resources, we all share our expertise to work towards a real transformational change. And we have seen, and probably this goes more towards your next question, Jason, but we have seen experiences in many countries, and particularly in my country, Peru, where today, after decades of working with the startups and the entrepreneurship movement, Peru today is, for the 24 countries that receive impact investing in the region, Peru is number 7 of one of the countries receiving most impact investing investment, promoting innovation, promoting economic development, and bringing more and more attention from impact investors. Colombia, Brazil, Mexico are examples of how paying attention to entrepreneurship, supporting them with the technical assistance, the access to networks, and elevating them and their businesses to the level of investment readiness can create this pool of external foreign private investors that can support economic development through entrepreneurship. We know also for studies, and particularly from the Global Impact Investing Investment Network that issues annual reports, that impact investing in the world, the last study that I reviewed was a 2017 survey or annual report, show $100 billion in impact investing. That grew in 2018 to $20 billion. In 2019, before the pandemic, it went to $501 billion. And even during the pandemic, that number is close to $715 billion of impact investing in the world. So there is a wealth of resources that investors, particularly the ones that we are talking to, for example, the World Bank, the International Finance Institution, the Inter-American Development Bank, Impact Lab, areas, they are all interested in deploying impact investing. However, there is not a pipeline of entrepreneurs or entrepreneurship initiatives that are ready to receive this funding. So one of the goals of GDA is through a direct intervention is the creation of a regional accelerator that will work directly with these startups, with these entrepreneurs, to prepare them to receive these impact investing. So I'm going a little bit ahead of myself talking about what GDA is proposing to do and talking about a little more on impact investing. But I will stop here, Jason, to kind of organize a little bit the questions that you had in mind and get back to you.
Well, Paty, I'm just so glad you're here. I mean, that's the thing. The fact that you can be lucid and clear after having the COVID diagnosis and dealing with that, I'm very glad you're here. Thank you for being sharp. It's wonderful because this information is some that people just don't hear about in a very clear way. For example, people hear impact investing and it sounds like philanthropy. Can you explain how impact investing essentially is not charity? What's the difference?
I love that question, Jason, because thinking about the clients that your company works with, which are wealthy individuals or family groups that want to keep creating wealth and getting your advice on what are the best ways to manage their financial assets. Impact investing at this point represents enormous interesting opportunities for everybody, not just for the large corporations, not just for the governments or larger institutions. At this point, what we are seeing is that foundations and families are taking impact investing as their way to give away money through philanthropy that aligns their values in lives and their mission in the world with enterprises that are recipients of these dollars, these investments, that can also provide return to those investments. So to give you an example, Global Development Advisors, GDA, is proposing to work with enterprises and entrepreneurs and startups in the Northern Triangle region that propose businesses that have two main goals: an impact, a social impact in their communities, taking the framework of the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals, the 17 goals that look to or search or seek to impact access to water and sanitation, improving health, reducing poverty, supporting agriculture. So if any of the businesses that we target have one of these goals in mind, that is providing philanthropists with a way to invest your dollars for a social cause. But these institutions offer also a financial return for those investments, meeting the second goal of these impact investors, making a social impact with their investments and receiving some return in as a result of those investments. And it's interesting that not too long ago, Jason, I read this survey done by US Trust that work with financial advisors and some of the more important clients of these financial advisors' portfolios. And 32% of these individuals, these financial advisors' clients, refer that in their conversations with their financial advisors, philanthropy as a way of investment wasn't discussed. 40% of those same individuals were saying that they will prefer hiring a financial advisor that is knowledgeable on the philanthropic aspect of their investments for a social and a financial return. So impact investing now is, as I mentioned before, not only open to the large investors, the wealthy of us, but to everybody that want to contribute to improve the world and make some return at the same time.
So what I'm hearing from you is not enough of the people in my industry have a good enough understanding of impact investing, where yes, you can be a social entrepreneur, it could be a social cause, a social company, but you are getting a return. It's not, I'm gonna give $10,000 and I'm gonna hope they do well. It's, I'm gonna give $10,000 and maybe I get 10,000, 200, 300, 500 back, whatever. And I feel good about the fact that I supported an organization that's doing good in the world. Am I understanding that correctly?
Exactly. Investors work to keep their endowments healthy and strong. They have, when talking about foundations in general, they have an arm of mission deployment of money through grants, as you say. Yes, we deploy $10,000 to a nonprofit organization, expecting reports of those results, but I'm not expecting any type of financial return. Through impact investing, that same foundation, that same individual could give those dollars away through a grant, but instead they could give that money to a social enterprise that is proposing an impact in their communities, but can also give this investor, this foundation, a return that keeps that endowment healthy. So when financial advisors work with individuals, it will be interesting to provide the fan of opportunities that could merge those two very important goals, not just for investments, but particularly for social impact.
One of the titles I hope to have one day is social entrepreneur, Paty. That's how I see you. And I mean, how amazing it must be to know that your work is helping communities directly. It's not a question. It's just terrific.
Thank you.
Let me ask this question in a more specific way. I know we touched on why to invest in Central America and say the names of the countries again, so people actually know, you know, the difference between South America, North America, by the way, and which is Mexico, and Central America, the Hondurases, the Guatemalas. Mention those names of those companies. There's just a handful. And describe again, why take the risk of investing in countries within Central America versus countries in South America like Peru, which are successful now?
Yeah, that's a very interesting question. The countries we are referring to as the Central American countries for our intervention are El Salvador, Honduras, and Guatemala, which are named by the United States or the federal government as the Northern Triangle countries in Central America. However, when talking to them, to their institutions or their individual citizens, they don't call themselves a Northern Triangle country. So I have learned that I have to refer to them as the countries in the northern side of Central America instead. You ask why
invest there instead of a safer bet in South America?
And I think I mentioned before, when we're looking at the map of impact investing in the world, and I was back in 2019, I was participating in this class at Oxford University, a social finance class. And one of the exercises was kind of investigating and looking deeper into the impact investing map in the world. So my eyes immediately went to where the gaps were. And evidently, the Central America region presents a gap, a desert of impact investing. And when talking to my potential investors and potential donors for our research component, Jason, it's funny to hear from them, why do you want to go there when nobody is there? Why don't you go to Peru? Why don't you go to Colombia? And my natural response is just, that is precisely why we have to go there, because nobody else is there. Because I deeply trust in the region and its potential and the relevance of these times to help them. They have been hit, as everybody else, by COVID. Central America has Honduras has gone through two hurricanes late last year. There is, like I said, like we all know, a massive migration from those countries to the United States. And we cannot deny that the consequence of removing, back in 2019, completely the aid that was offered to these countries by the federal government increased corruption, increased violence, increased gangs activity. So yes, this is the moment. And the other political reason why, Jason, is that if we fail to support the Central America region, we are not only not reducing the mass migration, but we are also allowing China to increase their influence and their presence in the region. So that right there, another reason why we have to gather our resources, our knowledge, and our money to invest in this region. What GDA is proposing is three phases of intervention. The first one is to a research study that we look to identify clear evidence-based conclusions to what the core problems are in the region, but specifically the connection of those problems with the business ecosystem and how the deployment of new funding, vocational and technical education, access to networks, access to these funds will directly contribute to what that region needs. So the first phase, I got a little lost there. The first phase of the approach, the initiative, the intervention is to execute this study. The conclusions of that study will serve us for the second phase of our intervention, which is the implementation of a regional accelerator. So what the study will provide us is with what are the gaps that exist in the accelerator incubator ecosystem at this point that entrepreneurs are not receiving and that can increase their opportunities to succeed. So working directly with enterprises and entrepreneurs from these three countries, providing this programming, this content, to take them to the first phase of our intervention, which is the creation of this impact investment fund that I have been mentioning, will bring foreign and private investments to be deployed there and to support enterprises that have a social and a financial return as the core business model.
And what was part three? The first part is the study. The second part is the implementation of a regional accelerator. Is that also the creation of the impact investing vehicle, or is that number three?
The third phase is the creation of the impact investment fund.
Got it. So the second phase is the implementation of the accelerator, the regional accelerator.
And what we are basing our research on what we have collected from all the research that has been done by different institutions, but focusing our questions on the Aspen Institute for Network for Development Enterprises. Aspen is the acronym. They put out a research report in 2018 that is called the Research Agenda for the Development of the Small and Growing Business Sector. So it's the evidence and the research needs that it still exists in the ecosystem. So we are taking those recommendations from that report and basing our study there with two arms. One is going to be a country risk study that is going to measure the political, the economic, and the social risk that these countries represent. Connect that with the second arm of the study, which is an ecosystem, entrepreneurial ecosystem study that collects the voices of all the stakeholders in the ecosystem through artificial intelligence. We are going to use algorithms that will collect the information that entrepreneurs and other ecosystem agents volunteer on social media and other internet platforms, and combine those two elements, seeking the conclusions and recommendations of what type of intervention will guide the second phase for the creation of the regional accelerator.
It's incredibly comprehensive, and you've got all of the stages for success. And I've got to apologize, I've got that saying global impact advisors, that should be global development advisors. Now you're working on a website for this too, is that right?
Yes, and as another startup, we are at this point at the startup stage of GDA. There are so many elements that we are taking care of. So being ready with the website is not, it is definitely a priority, but having these type of conversations and meetings and hosting different panels and just gathering more information, but especially fundraising.
Yeah, fundraising as well. Because there is a fundraising element where people who do want to use this as a vehicle for their charity, they can, for their philanthropy, they can. And then there's an impact investing portion to this, which is people investing in a social cause, but getting a return. So you've got an option here as a person with funding. Am I correct?
Correct. And we are GDA, it's fundraising itself to execute the first phase, which is the study. And the beauty of donors that are joining us on this effort, Jason, is that we will own the data and we will own the recommendations that will trigger the execution of the programs and the resources and services that will create the accelerator, the regional accelerator. So, and we are open at that point to share our findings with everyone interested in executing some type of programming or investment in the region.
Got it. And so, yeah, the organization itself is going to have a little, as they say, skin in the game. They're going to invest some of their own funds along with others to make this change within Central America. And speaking of that, just as we get to our last question here, how do you see, if everything goes well, if the Biden administration's $4 billion plan execution goes well, if the Global Development Advisors phase one, phase two, phase three goes well, how do you see those countries in the Northern Triangle within Central America changing over the next 10, 15, 20 years?
Creating that, as I think I mentioned at the beginning, the next great success story of the Western Hemisphere, where families, children, and young individuals from those countries don't have to flee, that they don't see any need to leave their countries because there is so much wealth and prosperity, because they are able to utilize the natural resources, their intellectual capacity to create better futures for those communities, to eradicate corruption, to create jobs, so there is no fertile soil for guns and violence to grow.
And so what I'm hearing from you is there are opportunities for investors to get a return. There are opportunities for the residents of those countries to stay home and achieve prosperity at home. And I think as a result, the symptom of crowding at the U.S. border, the symptom of challenges we have in and around in the politicization of our immigration policies, those things can all be improved with some of this.
That is the main goal of our intervention, to reduce that mass migration from those countries to the United States, and to contribute to the United Nations Sustainable Development Goals that creates wealth and prosperity by 2030.
Fantastic, fantastic. Well, I'm gonna stop the share, so everyone brace yourselves. We're back to faces covering the entire box here. Paty, I'm just so thankful that you were able to share so much of your knowledge. There's so much more to know. For people that are gonna be watching this presentation later, what is one thing that they can do to engage this issue of Central America and the challenges that people of a few of those countries face and then we face? I mean, how can people get involved? One thing.
Well, educate ourselves. It is, as you said at the very beginning, it is really hard to be empathic and understand the challenges and the obstacles from the United States, from our safe and secure place. So invite everybody, I will invite everybody to connect, to ask questions, to learn, to put ourselves in those situations and take some type of action. I'm here to collect ideas, to collect funds that will increase our opportunities for our intervention to succeed.
So whether it's investors who are prepared with funds, whether it's people just trying to learn, you are going to be a resource and point people to many, many other resources where they can get a better understanding of what's happening both in Central America and by default, our U.S. border as well.
Absolutely. We owe that to those communities.
Patricia Funegra, La Cocina, Virginia, Global Development Advisors, thank you so much for being a part of our talk today, this presentation today, for being the educator for all of us, and not only today, but for those who will watch this going forward. We appreciate you joining us and hope you have a great rest of the year where you get to bring some more impact and send us that website, okay?
Absolutely, I will. Thank you so much for the opportunity. We'll stay in touch.
And with that, we yield the balance of your time. Bye-bye.
Thank you. Bye-bye.